How was it possible for a pirate ship to start a decades-long civil war? This is the real story of a young and beautiful prince who lost everything in one night. Welcome to History Tower. We travel back to the fateful night of November 15th, 1120, to a white-painted longship, an oak ship of Viking design, with nearly 200 party guests celebrating in the port of Barfleur, France. The moored ship was loaded with many barrels of wine and had been provided by a merchant for the crossing from Normandy to England along the troubled sea in the late autumn on the English Channel to transport the young and beautiful offspring from the elite families of England and Normandy. At the center of this celebration was the handsome 17-year-old Prince William Efeling, also known as William Adelin, dressed in silk, gold-embroidered robes, and cared for and protected by servants and guards. Because he was highly revered and pampered as the firstborn son and heir to the throne, he had developed a tendency towards arrogance. But his arrogance had been justified, at least so far, because he had already achieved extraordinary things as a 17-year-old. William was named after his legendary grandfather William the Conqueror, who had conquered England in 1066, 54 years before his grandson, the 17-year-old Prince William Efeling, boarded the white ship at the French port city Barfleur. William's mother was Queen Matilda of Scotland, who descended from the Anglo-Saxon House of Wessex, and his father was Henry I, who descended from the House of Normandy that had been founded by the Viking warrior Rollo. The marriage of his parents connected the old English house with the Norman house and tried to close the old wounds after the conquest of his grandfather. In the same way, the young Prince William had married the Duchess Matilda of Anjou to overcome the old hostilities and rivalries with the neighboring regions through the alliance with the House of Anjou. Whether there was love between Prince William and Duchess Matilda has not been handed down, but both fulfilled their duty and married in June 1119 in the small northern French town of Lisieux. Just like his parents, the young Prince William married to enforce a regional peace and for an alliance between the Normans and Angevins, who had been enemies for generations. His wife Matilda of Anjou became the abbess of the monastery of Fontevrault 8 years after his death in 1128 and died in 1154. Prince William had probably grown up in the legendary Tower of London, which had been built by his grandfather William the Conqueror as a seat of power. He received lessons to prepare him for his role as heir to the throne. Moreover, because of his diligence in learning to govern, the prince was already referred to in official documents as Rex Designatus, which means designated prospective king. His role as future king is also confirmed by the fact that William was paid homage by the barons of Normandy in 1115 and by the barons of England in 1116. After his marriage, he travelled for a year with his father, King Henry I, through Normandy to be taught how to govern. In November 1119, he accompanied his father to a meeting with their distant relative, Pope Calixtus II, in the small French town Gisoire. Likewise, in 1120, Prince William was present at the negotiation for the peace treaty with the dangerously clever, chubby French King Louis VI. When Prince William knelt before Louis VI and swore allegiance to him as the new Duke of Normandy, it not only meant that his father Henry I was handing the Duchy of Normandy to the prince, but also that William was recognized as a leading figure in Europe.
Only weeks after this high point in his life, the prince boarded the white ship that would bring death and decades of destruction. So in November 1120, the young prince had many reasons to celebrate. That night he was drunk, as were the young nobles and the ship's crew. The white ship was excellent for the crossing, with room for several hundred guests, a ship's crew of 50 men, and ample cargo space for a royal household. It was long and huge, with carvings on the bow and stern, a tall mast and rectangular sails. In the evening, the crew and passengers said goodbye to the king's ship, which departed before them. Although they should have followed the king's ship, they stayed in the harbor until dark to celebrate and drink. Some priests who wanted to bless the prince's ship with holy water were driven away amid cheering and laughter. Also, the ship's captain was so drunk that he claimed he and his 50 oarsmen could catch up to the ship of the king. This captain was Thomas Fitzstephen, whose father had been the captain who had transported William the Conqueror from Normandy to England during his invasion in 1066. The statement of the drunk captain raised concerns among Stephen of Blois, the prince's cousin, that a crossing in the darkness at high speed with a drunken crew would be too dangerous. He claimed to have an indigestion and, with several other passengers, sought another ship to travel to England. Stephen's decision to change ships changed the history of England, which we will come back to later. At midnight, the white ship departed under the new moon. After a few minutes, its journey was over. The ship with the drunken prince on board rammed a sharp rock called Kilboeuf, which still juts out of the water at the harbor exit nowadays. The rock punched a hole in the carved wooden bow of the ship, which filled with ice-cold water. Some passengers were thrown into the water by the impact. Their beautiful, precious robes filled up with the seawater and became so heavy that people struggled not to drown. Under the new moon, the screams of the drowning and desperate were mistaken for party noises by the people at the shore. The drunken crew frantically scooped the water out of the ship, while the prince with a few companions and oarsmen got into a lifeboat. On his way back to the harbor, Prince William heard the screams of his older half-sister, Countess Matilda Fitzroy, who was drowning, and shouted after him not to leave her so barbarically. At that moment, William decided to give the order to turn back to save his half-sister, and thus change the history of England. When the drowning people saw the lifeboat, they tried to climb aboard, causing the prince's lifeboat to capsize and sink. Matilda drowned, as did her half-brothers Richard of Lincoln and Prince William, Duke of Normandy and future King of England. Prince William Atheling's compassion and love for his half-sister had killed him and everyone in the lifeboat. The chronicler Henry of Huntingdon described the contrast of the fate of the 17-year-old prince. Instead of wearing embroidered robes, floated naked in the waves, and instead of ascending a lofty throne, found his grave at the bottom of the sea. The sole survivor was named Berold and was a butcher from Rouen, who had only been taken on the white ship by chance because he wanted to collect outstanding debts. The butcher Berold fought death all night by wrapping himself in goatskins against the cold and clinging to a piece of wreckage. Supposedly, Berold informed the ship's captain that the prince had died, whereupon the captain allowed himself to sink. In the morning, with the help of a fisherman, the butcher made it to shore, where a few bodies washed up. However, most of the dead were never found, like Prince William Atheling.
His father, King Henry I, had arrived safely on the coast of England and was preparing for Christmas with his household. The news of the sunken ship in Barfleur caused a shock throughout the court. To tell the king the news of the death of his beloved son and heir to the throne, Prince William, the official sent a young boy to King Henry, who threw himself at his feet and wept as he told about the white ship. The king, overcome with shock, horror, and grief, sank to the ground.
Supposedly, he never smiled again after that.
An entire generation of Anglo-Norman nobles had been almost completely wiped out. With Prince William Atheling, peace between the houses of Normandy and Anjou had been secured, as well as peace with France and the succession to the English throne. Without him, a new heir to the throne had to be found.
The only legitimate and surviving child of King Henry was Empress Matilda, who had lived in Germany for 10 years and had married Henry V, the German king and Holy Roman Emperor. However, when she became a widow in 1125, she traveled back to England and she was sworn allegiance as heir to the throne at court by the Anglo-Norman barons at Christmas 1126, even though her choice as heir to the throne was unpopular because of her gender. On the 17th of June 1128,
Empress Matilda married the brother of Prince William's wife Matilda of Anjou to re-establish an alliance with the House of Anjou. Her groom Geoffrey was only 15, had red hair, was tall and so handsome that he was nicknamed Le Belle, the Beautiful. Allegedly, he liked to wear yellow genista in his hair or on his helmet, which in Latin is called Plantagenet,
which is why Geoffrey's nickname was Geoffrey Plantagenet and why he is considered to be the founder of the brutal House of Plantagenet, which ruled England for centuries. Although Empress Matilda should have ascended the throne, the power was immediately taken from her. Because Stephen of Blois, the cousin of Empress Matilda and Prince William, who had escaped the White Ship at that time because he had sought another ship, overtook the throne. After the death of King Henry I on December 1st, 1135, Stephen claimed that on his deathbed the king had named Stephen heir to the throne instead of Empress Matilda. When Stephen of Blois took over the reign, two factions emerged. One faction was Team Stephen, and one faction was Team Matilda. The resulting civil war was cruel and lasted actively for about 15 years. The events led to the peace treaty of Wallingford in Wallingford Castle, of which the ruins still stand today. Stephen agreed with his cousin Empress Matilda that he would remain king until his death, but after that, Matilda's son would take over the reign. This son ascended the throne as Henry II, who is considered to be the first king of the House of Plantagenet.
The Plantagenets are still infamous today as an outstanding, cruel, and legendary dynasty of England. 901 years after its sinking, an expedition team managed to find the alleged shipwreck on June 8, 2021, with the help of a proton magnetometer, which is a powerful underwater metal detector. While scanning the seafloor, the metal detector discovered bronze and iron fittings at the ship's hull, as well as an elongated wreck. The oak hull planks were stacked on top of each other like Viking longships. It was the only shipwreck in the area. The video and photos are linked in the video description as I can't show them due to copyright reasons.
The expedition was carried out by the Institute of Digital Archaeology and supported by Earl Charles Spencer, the brother of Princess Diana of the British royal family, who has published a book about the history of the White Ship. I put the link of him on a podcast episode about the White Ship tragedy in the description.
The tragedy of the White Ship and its aftermath was succinctly and precisely summarized by the Anglo-Norman monk and historian William of Malmesbury shortly after the event. No ship ever brought so much misery to England.